Good morning. Welcome to the Auburn Unitarian Universalist Fellowship. My name is Jason Pratt and I'll be serving as service associate today. We welcome all of you to our service, especially those of you who are searching for a spiritual home. Many of us were once too seeking for something larger than ourselves to which we could belong, a sense of rootedness to hold us as we create meaning together. We do that well here, though not perfectly. In this congregation, we strive not for perfection, but for authenticity and connection. Whether it is your first time in worship with us or your 100th time, we hope that you'll find here questions that stretch you, people to befriend you, and liberal religious values that challenge you to join us in loving boldly, living justly, and welcoming radically. On behalf of the members of the fellowship, I extend a special welcome to all visitors who are joining us online for the first time, and to those of you who still feel like visitors. If you have not already done so, please fill out a digital visitor card by visiting auf.org/visitor so that we may welcome you. You may also contact our minister, Reverend Chris Rothbauer, at minister@auf.org with any questions or concerns you might have. Let us move into the service, willing to be authentic with each other, honest within ourselves, and opening to connection in all its forms.
Our opening words are from Katie Kandarian Morris. Here we have come into this sacred space, quieter now with our readiness, hushed voices, hoping, trusting for so many things, for connection, for communion, for inspiration, for information, for healing, for wholeness, for words, for music, for celebration and consolation. Here we have come into this sacred space, bringing all of who we are. Let us be willing, however we are changed. Come, let us worship together.
Seen the kids or the adults in a while, I just want to say hi and thinking of you. So remember, safe form, good form, good form, safe form. Be aware of your muzzle, your banjo, where your hands and feet are, and carry on smartly and safely.
I invite you to light your chalice with us this morning with these words from Maureen Killoran. For every time we make a mistake, we decide to start again, we light this chalice. For every time we are lonely and we let someone be our friend, we light this chalice. For every time we are disappointed and we choose to hope, we light this chalice. As is our tradition, we also light a candle in solidarity with those families separated at our southern border. One of the ways that we proclaim the warmth and caring of our community is by sharing our joys, concerns, and milestones. We invite those who wish to use the Zoom chat box to type your joy, concern, or milestone during the music for meditation. If you wish for your joy or concern to be acknowledged, but don't want to share it, you may also type that you have an unspoken joy or concern.
One thing I wanted to bring to you all this morning was that, was in case you didn't see the announcement on the AUUF listserv, that our Director of Religious Exploration, Julie Meadows, has let us know that she will be leaving us. She has put in her resignation. It's for personal reasons. She's let me know why, and I completely support and affirm her reasons and wish her nothing but the best in future endeavors. Julie will be staying on until the end of September to make sure that we have adequate transition to the new RE year, and that Emily, as chair of RE, and the RE teachers have the support that they're going to need to finish up the year, or to go through the year until we have a new director of religious exploration. I have started the process to hire a new DRE, and you all will be hearing more about that in the future. And we have a few weeks, and I hope if Julie has touched you during her time as DRE here at AUUF, that you will let her know and that you'll affirm it. And I know I speak for all of us when I say we're going to miss her. So please join me in thanking Julie. And you'll be hearing more about the DRE search in the next few weeks. Thank you.
May all the joys, concerns, and milestones of this community, those shared aloud and those held in silence, be received into the care and concern of all present. A religious community is like a river formed from the many streams of our lives that meet and merge and flow into the sea. As members and friends of this religious community, we share our time and energy, our creativity, imagination, and vision, our talents, skills, and gifts, and the streams of our individual lives to create a river that is both deep and broad, a river that is made of many streams, sustains life, and refreshes the land through which it flows. But the river of this community also depends on our shared financial support that makes real our shared value vision. We will now receive an offering for the support of this religious community and its work in the world. You are invited to give generously and joyfully as you are willing and able. You may make a donation online via PayPal please visit auuf.org/donate. If you are writing a check, please make your check payable to AUUF with a note on the memo line about whether it is for the offering or your pledge, and mail it to P.O. Box 669, Auburn, Alabama, 36831. The offering will now be gratefully received. We now have a reading from Howard Thurman. Waiting is a window opening on many landscapes. For some, waiting means the cessation of all activity, when energy is gone and exhaustion is all that the heart can manage. It is the long, slow panting of the spirit. For some, waiting is a time of intense preparation for the next leg of the journey. Here, at last, comes a moment when forces can be realigned and a new attack upon an old problem set in order. Or it may be a time for reassessment of all plans and of checking past failures against present insight. Waiting may be the long moment ahead when the landscape stretches far in many directions and the chance to select one's way among many choices cannot be denied. For some, waiting is a sense of disaster of the soul. It is what Francis Thompson suggests in the line, "Naked, I wait thy love's uplifted stroke." The last hiding place has been abandoned because the idea of escape is without meaning. Here is no fear, no panic, only the sheer excruciation of utter disaster. It is a kind of emotional blackout in the final moment before the crash. It is the passage through the zone of treacherous quiet. For many, waiting is something more than all of this. It is the experience of recovering balance when catapulted from one's place. It is the quiet forming of a pattern of recollection in which there is called into focus the fragmentary values from many encounters of many kinds in a lifetime of living. It is to watch a gathering darkness until all light is swallowed up completely, without the power to interfere or bring a halt. Then, in that darkness, to continue one's journey with one's footsteps guided by the illumination of remembered radiance. This is to know courage of a peculiar kind, the courage to demand the light to continue to be light, even in the surrounding darkness, to walk in the light while darkness invades, envelops, and surrounds. This is to wait on the Lord. This is to know the renewal of strength. This is to walk and faint not.
Of your mind, don't you know you might find a better place to play? You said that you've never been, but all the things that you've seen slowly fade away. So I'll start a revolution from my bed. As you said, the brains I had went to my head. Step outside, the summertime's in bloom. Stand up beside the fireplace and take that look from off your face. 'Cause you ain't ever gonna burn my heart out. Night or day, please don't put the life in the hands of a rock and roll band. We'll throw it all away. I'm gonna start a revolution from my bed. 'Cause you said the brains I had went to my head. Step outside, the summertime's in bloom. Stand up beside the fireplace and take that look from off your face. 'Cause you ain't ever gonna burn my heart out. Thank you. heard you say.
So let's face it, it's been a hell of a spring and summer. Life as we knew it has been turned upside down, and there aren't clear ways to stay safe right now, so we've had to figure out our own response and hope what we're doing is right. It's been a disconcerting experience, to say the least, one that I'm not sure I'll ever adjust to. And I'm not sure I believe we should get used to it. I don't know about you all, but I'm tired and really missing doing the things that I used to do on my days off before this happened. I suspect that many of you will agree with me. These are times of fear and uncertainty and consternation. Not working out of my office largely right now, it's felt like I've been waking up each day, every day, and life has kind of gone the same most days. It's become very predictable. Even my days off, which I used to spend taking trips out of town or out with the dog, have largely been spent at home watching Netflix and YouTube. Things that used to bring me so much pleasure have become unpredictable. Life itself seems to be stuck in an endless loop, and it's not helped that by the fact that this is one of the most atypical election cycles in my lifetime, and that there's a lack of any sort of comprehensive leadership coming from our elected officials, or even a plan of how we're going to safely get back to some semblance of balance. You would be forgiven for feeling like you're on a roller coaster that you want to get off, a fun park ride that's long since run its course. None of us are happy with our current reality, and there is a lot of anxiety in our national system about what is coming next. And this continual lack of balance can be bad for you. Psychologist Dr. Raquel Bild Libin says that this feeling could impact your mental health if not kept in check. When we're in this situation, depression becomes much more common, she says. People sometimes tend to feel like they have nothing to do, so they stay in bed a whole lot longer. It makes us feel like we have nothing to live for, and we stop even trying. So it feels very appropriate that the 1993 Harold Ramis-directed film Groundhog Day has become a favorite for Netflix watching during the pandemic. In the weeks immediately following quarantine, it in fact became one of the most watched movies in the United States on Netflix. It's since been trending for months, and for good reasons. I recently rewatched it for the first time in years, largely because Calvin had never seen it, so I decided we needed to watch it for our movie night. And it was then that I realized just how applicable the film is to our current reality. In some ways, we're currently living in a perpetual Groundhog Day, even if it's not February 2nd, even if it's not in Pennsylvania with snow on the ground. But it does feel like things will never change, like the course of the universe has spiraled beyond our control. If you're not familiar, Groundhog Day revolves around a day, we'll get to what I mean by that in quotes in a moment, in the life of Phil Connors, played by Bill Murray, a cynical and narcissistic TV weatherman from Pittsburgh, covering an annual Groundhog Day event in Punxsutawney, Pennsylvania, an assignment he's been given for the last 4 years. The film starts normally enough, showing the events on the evening of February 1st at Phil's station, as well as the drive over to Punxsutawney with his cameraman, Larry, played by Chris Elliott, and his new producer, Rita Hansen, played by Andy McDowell. As they drive, Connors makes it no secret that he hates the assignment. The people who live in the town, hicks as he puts it, and lets it be known he's moving up to bigger and better things soon, a national station. This, he declares, will be the last time he ever has to go to Punxsutawney.
Can you keep a secret, Larry? I'm probably leaving PBH, so this will be the last time we do the Groundhog together.
I don't understand what's wrong with the Groundhog Festival. You know, when I worked in San Diego, I covered the Swallows returning to Capistrano 6 years in a row.
Someday somebody's gonna see me interviewing a groundhog. I think I don't have a future.
I think it's a nice story. He comes out. He looks around. He wrinkles up his little nose. He sees his shadow. He doesn't see his shadow. It's nice. People like it.
You are new, aren't you? You know, people like blood sausage, too. People are morons.
Nice attitude.
I want you to look in the mirror and see what you look like when you do that little groundhog thing, okay? For me, let's. He comes out. And there he looks at us in the shadow. Would you like some blood sausage? I have some here in the glove compartment.
I like blood sausage.
They say it's gone.
So that night seems uneventful. As Connor settles into his bed and breakfast to get some rest before the next day. And nothing out of the ordinary seems to happen on February 2nd either. It's a rather unremarkable day in the life of a weatherman, with Connors covering the Groundhog Day Festival professionally, if not a bit cynically, seeing an old annoying high school classmate in town, and trying to get out as quickly as possible so he doesn't have to spend another night there. But a snowstorm forces the three to go back to Punxsutawney, and Connors, angrily but reluctantly, settles in for another night, determined to get out the next day. But something seems out of the ordinary the next day. Connors wakes up to the same Sonny and Cher song that greeted him the previous morning, has the same conversation with the B&B manager and a patron, meets his high school classmate again, and even finds himself covering the Groundhog Day Festival. Again. It is February 2nd all over again. Everything is happening just as it did the previous day, and Connors is apparently the only person who realizes it. And it's not just that day. No matter what Connors does, he always wakes up the next day to the same Sonny and Cher song. Each time, it's Groundhog Day. He's always in Punxsutawney, and the same things are happening over and over again. Connors can remember everything that happened in the previous versions of February 2nd, and his actions even can affect the way events turn out that day. For instance, on one day, he decides to get drunk and run from the police, leading to a high-speed pursuit and his death when his car stalls on railroad tracks. On another day, he tries his hand at bank robbery and after watching the drivers for several days. He even starts learning about people every day so that eventually he knows everything about them and can even manipulate them. but nothing he does brings February 3rd. He even tries multiple times to kill himself. But no matter how violent or how seemingly permanent his death, he always wakes up to the same Sonny and Cher song, to the same February 2nd, remembering he died the night before, but not being able to understand why he's still alive or why it's not February 3rd. No amount of struggle brings the next day to reality. Now there's an interesting story structure that you might not realize here. Writer Danny Rubin purposely structured Connor's experiences around Swiss-American psychiatrist Elizabeth Kubler-Ross's famous 5 stages of grief. Connor starts out in denial, not accepting what's happening to him is true, and even trying to seek professional help, although that's kind of hard when you have to see a psychiatrist for the first time every single day. He proceeds to anger, first towards others. He punches his annoying classmate after hearing his spiel yet again, and then toward himself when he tries to commit suicide. He arrives in bargaining, trying to figure out a way out, trying to kill the titular groundhog when he decides the groundhog must be the cause of the predicament. Of course, it doesn't work. Connors actually starts contemplating he could be God, and it's obvious he's treating the world at this stage like objects, merely to be known but useless to him because he can't get to February 3rd.
I'm sorry? What was that again?
I'm a god.
You're a god.
I'm a god. I'm not the god. I don't think.
Because you survived a car wreck?
You folks ready to order?
I didn't just survive a wreck. I wasn't just blown up yesterday. I have been stabbed, shot, poisoned, frozen, hung, electrocuted, and burned.
Oh, really?
And every morning I wake up without a scratch on me, not a dent in the fender. I am an immortal.
Special today is blueberry waffles.
Why are you telling me this?
Because I want you to believe in me.
You're not a god. You can take my word for it. This is 12 years of Catholic school talking.
I could come back if you're not ready.
How do you know I'm not a god?
Oh, please.
How do you know?
Because it's not possible.
I'll come back.
Doris. This is Doris. Her brother-in-law, Carl, owns this diner. She's worked here since she was 17. More than anything else in her life, she wants to see Paris before she dies.
Oh, boy, what a...
What are you doing?
This is Debbie Kleiser and her fiancé, Fred.
Do I know you?
They're supposed to be getting married this afternoon, but Debbie is having second thoughts.
What?
Lovely ring.
This is Bill. He's been a waiter for 3 years since he left Penn State and had to get work. He likes the town, he paints toy soldiers, and he's gay.
I am.
This is Gus. He hates his life here. He wishes he stayed in the Navy.
Well, I could have retired on half pay after 20 years.
Excuse me? Is this some kind of trick?
Well, maybe the real God uses tricks. You know, maybe he's not omnipotent. He's just been around so long, he knows everything.
Oh, okay. Well, who's that?
This is Tom. He worked in the coal mine until they closed it down.
And her?
It's Alice. Came over here from Ireland when she was a baby. She lived in Erie most of her life.
He's right. And her?
Nancy. She works in the dress shop and makes noises like a chipmunk when she gets real excited.
Hey!
It's true.
How do you know these people?
I told you, I know everything. In about 5 seconds, a waiter's gonna drop a tray of dishes. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Okay?
Okay, that's enough. What about me, Phil? Do you know me too?
I know all about you. You like producing, but you open for more than Channel 9 Pittsburgh.
Well, everyone knows that.
You like boats, but not the ocean. You go to a lake in the summer with your family up in the mountains. There's a long wooden dock and a boathouse with boards missing from the roof. And a place you used to crawl underneath to be alone. You're a sucker for French poetry and rhinestones. You're very generous. You're kind to strangers and children. And when you stand in the snow, you look like an angel.
How are you doing this?
I told you, I wake up
every day, right here, right in Punxsutawney, and it's always February 2nd. And there's nothing I can do about it. If you still can't believe me, listen. In 10 seconds, Larry is going to come through that door and take you away from me. But you can't let him.
Larry.
Please believe me. You've got to believe.
You guys ready? We better get going if we're gonna stay ahead of the weather. What's that?
If we're gonna stay ahead of the weather.
Connor's knowledge about the town at this point is only useful in convincing Rita to believe him. At this stage, he isn't actually accepting anything, but reacting to what is happening. And so often, when we're in these situations, we get stuck amid denial, anger, and bargaining. I know I've had a lot of denial, anger, and bargaining myself during these times. And it's eventually that we realize it's not getting us anywhere. Sometimes it's anger towards a friend, or denial about the systemic injustice in our nation, or bargaining around just how much the system needs to change for it to be just. It's so easy to get caught up in the endless cycle of feelings, like every day is just like the last. Sometimes people never realize in their lifetimes how counterproductive their responses are, because unlike Connor's, eventually, they don't wake up on February 2nd. Lao Tzu, the ancient Taoist philosopher, believed that this was living life against the Tao, or the way. In other words, we struggle against the way things are so much that we don't make any progress on our path in life. We may even hit the fourth stage of grief, depression, because it seems like everything we do is useless. Connors certainly hits that fourth stage shortly after our last clip, especially when he realizes that none of his godlike knowledge could win him the love of Rita. And again, it's so easy to get stuck in this fourth stage, but Connors has every day to think about his existential situation, whether he likes it or not. Eventually, something begins to happen. Something begins to shift. He starts using his new knowledge of how each day is going to be to try to improve the world, saving people's lives, learning to play the piano, even providing couples counseling to a young newlywed couple having second thoughts. He even learns he's not God. And he can't save anyone when he spends multiple days trying to save the life of an elderly homeless man who ultimately succumbs to age and illness despite all Connor's attempts to save him. And something magical happens. As Connor learns to accept his lot in life and just do what he can, he becomes a changed man, a better man. As Rita learns on Connor's final February 2nd, when she discovers just how many people he saved that day.
Thank you.
Proud.
Thank you. Hello, welcome to our party.
Phil, I didn't know you could play like that.
Oh, I'm versatile.
Nice young man from the motor club. Thank you again.
It's nothing, ladies.
He's the fastest jack in Jefferson County.
What was that all about?
I really don't know. They've been hitting on me all night.
There you are. I never thanked you properly for what you did for Buster.
Well, he would have choked for sure.
Well, he may have. He was trying to swallow a whole cow.
I owe you one, buddy.
Hang on to him, dear. He's a real find.
What did you do today?
Oh, same old, same old.
Excuse me, Mr. Connors.
Hey, Fred, how was the wedding?
Well, I just wanted to thank you for making Debbie go through with it and everything.
All I did was fan the flame of her passion for you, Fred.
You are the best.
No, you are the best. Rita, this is Debbie and Fred Kleiser.
Hi.
Here you go, kids. Congratulations.
What is this? No way.
WrestleMania! No way!
No, we're like gonna be in Pittsburgh anyway.
Thank you, Mr. Connors. You're a real pal.
Oh, this is the best.
I don't understand.
Yeah, I guess not.
How does everyone know you? I mean, you only come here once a year, and you seem like the most popular person in town.
Excuse me?
Yes.
Dr. Connors?
Yes.
I want to thank you for fixing Felix's back. Oh. He can even help around the house again.
Well, I'm sorry to hear that, Felix.
Dr. Connors?
It's kind of an honorary title.
What is going on?
I really don't know.
No, there is something going on with you.
Would you like the long version or the short one?
Let's start with the short and go from there.
After this clip, we can see that Connors has learned to follow the Tao, the way that things are in the world, and he's working with it, working with what comes his way, not struggling against it, no matter how much he wishes it was different. And paradoxically, this is his salvation. It's only once he's reached this calm, accepting state that Japanese Buddhists call Zen that he is able to move forward. Not only does Rita fall in love with Connors, but he wakes up the next day to February 3rd. There's wisdom here I think we should heed. Following the Tao is not always easy. It certainly wasn't for Connors, and we don't have to like it. Our weatherman certainly didn't, and I don't blame him. Speculation on the movie is that he was in that cycle for anywhere from 10 to 100 years. Taoists believe that it is not following the Tao that brings suffering and pain into our lives. When we learn to let go of how we think the world should be and accept it as it is, that doesn't mean that we shouldn't try to get other people to follow the Tao as well, which would bring a potential systemic revolution to the world. But it does mean there's only one present, one opportunity to accept and be with the world as it is. What are the areas of your life where you're struggling against the way, where you haven't accepted the way things are? I realize that I'm having trouble accepting that it's dangerous to go out into large crowds. I'm an ambivert, and I really like to be in crowds sometimes. But that's not safe right now, and I haven't quite figured out what to do instead. Writing this sermon, I realized that maybe it's an opportunity to embrace the moment and even connect with folks in my life by Zoom. That's my challenge to you this week. We're all in Groundhog Day. Even if you're now getting to go out and back to work a little bit, it's still off kilter. But figure out the areas in your life right now where you're Phil Connors, where you're struggling against the way things are, and figure out what you're going to do to follow the Tao. It's not that there's not a place for Kubler-Ross's other stages of grief, but if they're not propelling us towards acceptance as a step towards change, are they helping us or are they ultimately harming us? Lao Tzu famously said, "When I let go of what I am, I become what I might be." And that's the paradox, as Connor's found out. Sometimes it's not until we let go of what we think we're supposed to be that we're able to wake up on our own February 3rd. But if I'm able to see the world for what it is, I might find it easier and less painful to shape the world as it should and could be. Acceptance and following the Tao doesn't just mean it's going to be this way forever. It just means that things are this way right now. May we find ways to accept what is, that we may be able to create what might be. And may we find wisdom in sometimes the most unlikely of places. May it be so. I'd like to invite you to join in our closing hymn, which is hymn number 128 in the Gray Hymnal, "For All That Is Our Life." The words will be shared on screen. Please join me in extinguishing our chalice. You'll find the words on screen. We extinguish this flame, but not the light of truth, the warmth of community, or the fire of commitment. These we carry in our hearts until we are together again. Is from Manish Mishra Marzetti. The universe sings no less because time and space wear us thin. The music calls us to recognize our limitations, to recognize that the song is best sung with others. Amen. Blessed be, and go in peace.